I call this meeting of the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. Can I get a motion for certification of closed session?
Mr. Chair, I certify to the best of each member's knowledge the Williamsburg James City County School Board while in closed session discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Ms. Serza, could you take the vote, please?
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. That brings us to 3.02, the Pledge of Allegiance. I've made four new friends tonight. Reese Granger, Cassie Paul, Julia Lynch, and Reagan Carino, who are fifth graders at Matoka Elementary School. And so they are going to allow us all time to stand and put our hand over our heart before they start.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, ladies. I appreciate that. Brings us to 3.03. Ms. Serza, could you take the roll, please?
Ms. Cook?
Here.
Ms. Hummel?
Here.
Ms. Miner?
Here.
Mrs. Taylor?
Here.
Mrs. Young?
Here.
Dr. Beers?
Here.
Mr. Kelly?
Here. Thank you. 4.01, approval of the agenda. Can I get a motion for approval of the agenda, please?
I make a motion that we approve the agenda as stated.
Thank you. Could I modify that to switch 6.02 school spotlight with 6.01 board recognitions? Would you be okay with that?
Yes.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 5.01, announcement superintendent's report. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Good evening, everyone. Toronto Middle School physical education teacher Ron Trainum has been named the 2016 SHAPE America National Middle School Physical Education Teacher of the Year. We recognized Ron earlier this year for being named Southern District Teacher of the Year, and he was then selected for the national title at the SHAPE America Convention. So we all extend our congratulations to Mr. Trainum. Jamestown High School is one of the 2016 top 100 best WISE high schools teaching personal finance. This national honor is from Working in Support of Education, a leading provider of financial education programs. Jamestown students scored amongst the highest in the country on the WISE Financial Literacy Certification Test. The 2016 ranking is based on school achievement in the 2014-2015 school year. Congratulations. Also from Jamestown, this past Saturday, students in the high school's History Honor Society, Rho Kappa, participated in National Junior Ranger Day at historic Jamestown. Jamestown students led children's games, crafts, and a mock archaeology dig, performed colonial dance and music, and acted as living history characters throughout the day. Students also had the opportunity to meet with the Deputy Superintendent of the National Park Service. Several photos from the day are available on the Jamestown Twitter feed. Elementary, middle, and high school level Teachers of the Year will be named soon and will be recognized along with all school Teachers of the Year at a reception next week. The division's Teacher of the Year will be selected from the three level Teachers of the Year. I look forward to announcing those names of these educators at our next board meeting. And those are all of our announcements this evening, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Constantino. Some great recognitions in there and good accolades for our school system. Do any other board members have any announcements that they'd like to make? Great. Thank you. Seems like we were just together last week. I think we were, actually. First of all, I'd like to thank the James City County Board of Supervisors and the James City County EDA for approval of the bond financing the construction of the new James Blair Middle School We're looking forward to getting that construction started and moving forward with that. And so we entered the busy part of our, every part's busy, but this is another busy part of our school year. The Lafayette has the Wizard of Oz this week, their musical production. They always do a great job at all of our high schools, and Lafayette included. And War Hill's coming up, so a lot of Dr. Constantino talked about the Teachers of the Year thing, so there's a lot of good stuff coming up. So that, we move on to 6.02, School Spotlight. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. This evening, our school spotlight is Matoka Elementary School, and Mr. Jacobs is making his way to the podium to kick off the presentation. Good evening, Mr. Jacobs.
Good evening, Chairman Kelly, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. Thank you so much for inviting us to spotlight happenings at Matoka Elementary School. Mr. Kelly, you may remember from a year or so ago we came before you and other board members and shared with you the creation of a happening that we were quite excited about and proud of, that being Girl Power. Girl Power was at the time an opportunity for us to address some of the social emotional stressors, needs, and opportunities that our oldest elementary schools have before them, our fifth graders. Since that time, we're back again to share with you more of the wonderful happenings with Girl Power, but we've expanded. Tonight we're going to share with you along gender equity lines, Guys Matter, and who better to tell you more about it than our two wonderful school counselors, Destiny Harris and Robert Hill.
Good evening. My name is Destiny Harris, and I'm a school counselor at Matoka Elementary School. And this year I've had the privilege of sponsoring Girl Power, a club for fifth grade girls. Girl Power is a club that aims to empower each member to show to how to manage and respond to typical pre-adolescent experiences, as well as problems that may arise throughout this stage of her development. During our lunchtime gatherings, we focus on topics geared towards preparation for middle school. As you can see here, we have an acronym, POWER. P stands for perseverance. Girls are encouraged to keep a positive attitude while overcoming challenges. O, occupation. We recognize the importance of setting short and long-term goals to achieve our dreams. W, well-being. Taking care of our bodies and minds to manage life stressors, because young people experience stress too. E, esteem. Recognizing your strengths. Developing self-confidence. Our relationships, the importance of choosing true friends, and positive strategies for handling conflict. One thing the girls look forward to is our annual sleepover. When we stay at school and gather in small groups to do team building and trust activities. The sleepover is at Matoka, and this year it was in March. And yes, I survived spending the night with over 30 fifth grade girls, and we got a little bit of sleep, and we had a lot of fun, thanks to the help of parent volunteers and William & Mary graduate students. Here is a picture of our current Girl Power Club, and I love working with these girls. We are a large club with about 47 members this year, and this evening I'm joined by Cassie Paul, Julia Lynch, Reese Granger, and Reagan Carino. And each will share with you what Girl Power has meant to them this school year.
Hello. Girl Power helped me let go and be myself.
Hear the microphone.
Hi. Girl Power has helped me to feel more confident and not care what anybody else thinks of me.
Hi. Girl Power helped me express my feelings and made me more confident.
In Girl Power, we work together in groups, and it let me feel good about myself.
Now I'll turn it over to Mr. Hill, who'll talk about Guys Matter.
Thank you, ladies.
All right. Good evening. My name is Robert Hill. I'm one of the school counselors at Matoka and also the sponsor for Guys Matter. Thank you, Mr. Kelly, school board, and Dr. Constantine for having us this evening. We would like to thank Mr. Jacobs and Ms. Van Lillewa for allowing us to have Guys Matter this year. Mrs. Harris for being a big supporter, and our parents for allowing their sons to participate in this first year of Guys Matter. God's men, we have 35 young men, exceptional young men, and we have worked hard to inspire a spirit of brotherhood and camaraderie amongst one another. With this program, we wanted to develop leadership skills and encourage academic performance, athletics, character development, as well as other achievements that they have accomplished. One of the key goals of this program was to allow the fifth grade males to have a safe haven where they can discuss topics and freely discuss topics amongst one another and also in a safe environment and feel comfortable doing so. So we've discussed topics such as focusing on dealing with unfriendly classmates or how to handle ourselves making good decisions, friendship issues and bullying. We've discussed building our confidence, I need to work on that, self-esteem, positive self-image and our emotions, which is, you know, tough for guys to really talk about, but we really opened up this year. Healthy life choices and peer pressure. We've also kind of talked about the middle school concerns that they have, like opening up a locker. You know, it's a big deal for them. So, and one of the many activities that we've done this year was with social skills, they were challenged to do a gentleman's challenge where they had to exude gentleman-like characteristics, and they had anonymous faculty and staff members who they did not know who was watching for a couple weeks, and they had to even dress the part of a gentleman where they had to dress like they're outdressing me tonight, but they look pretty good, so they had to dress up, and the teachers voted on Mr. Jack Marshall, our winner here, who's one of the students who is a representative that will, they've all are the epitome of what Guys Matter stands for, and they're here to tell us a little bit more about what they've done this year.
We had a middle school conversation. We talked about not giving into peer pressure, like not saying bad words because other people are. Also, we prepared for middle school by learning how to open the padlocks on our lockers. We had a bullying conversation. We talked about being an upstander and telling a teacher or huddling up if someone is bullying someone else. We also talked about never becoming a bully or helping a bully.
In Guys Matter, we learned to be a gentleman. We did a challenge about who could be the best gentleman around our school. There were people watching us to see what we did as judges. One day, we even had to dress up and wear a shirt and tie. I think I learned a lot in this group for our future in middle school. We learned to be nice and respectful, especially to girls and women. For example, to hold the door for women or girls, and always to return a compliment. And I think that is important because every boy should act like a gentleman.
Hello and good evening, distinguished members of the WJCC School Board. My name's Caleb Spells, and I'm a fifth grader here at Matoka Elementary School and a proud member of Guys Matter Boys Club. When I first heard that Guys Matter was starting at our school, I asked my parents to sign me up because I wanted to meet new people, make new friends, and have fun. And that's exactly what happened. Each week, we met to discuss things like team building, how to deal with bullying, self-esteem, leadership, and more. We also do fun activities like Super Bowl parties, kickball, and the human pretzel, just to name a few. But most of all, Mr. Hill teaches us how to have self-respect and to respect all of mankind. Guys Matter is a brotherhood that I am happy and proud to be a part of. I have made many friends, and I hope they have Guys Matter Boys Club at my middle school next year. Thank you for listening and for all allowing us to speak at tonight's school board meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll be going on vacation for a couple weeks, and Caleb will be taking over if that's okay. Thank you, boys and girls. You did an excellent job. For me, the opportunity to talk to you about and highlight girl power and Guys Matter is an opportunity. Of course, instruction is important. It is crucially important, but it's an opportunity for us to showcase that what's truly most important is the whole child and giving them opportunities to productively socialize and support one another and learn through life's lessons that we all sometimes tend to take for granted. Our school counselors have done a fantastic job providing the structure and the opportunities to do that. We hope that we're setting a course for success for our students as they approach their next solid transition, because just a couple of years back they were kindergartners coming to us, and now they're ready to set sail to be middle schoolers, and we hope that we're doing our part to make them strong, confident, and successful students. So certainly if you have any questions, I'm glad to answer them.
Any board members have any questions or comments? Go ahead.
Does the club exist at middle school?
Not in this particular fashion, but...
No pressure.
Yeah. It may soon, when Caleb gets there and others, yeah.
Okay. Any other... Thank you for these clubs, and I think this is a great thing for these kids to, you know, start to learn who they are and represent themselves in a proud manner. So I think this is a wonderful experience for them, and Caleb will do a great job. I have every confidence.
Thank you.
Thank you. 6.01, board recognitions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. We have a number of students to recognize tonight. Let's begin with 7 talented Clara Bird Baker students. The All Virginia Elementary Chorus provides an opportunity for students across the state to work with a master conductor, perform a varied repertoire of quality choral literature, and increase their knowledge of vocal skills. 7 CBB choir students were selected to participate in this statewide event. I'd like to ask Clara Bird Baker music teacher Jason Kreiner to come to the podium to announce the students. And students, please come to the front as your name is called and remain for a group photo. Mr. Kreiner.
Sadie Broltz. Kiara Butler. Sarika Campbell. Nicole Daniel. Ava Dilday. Elena Wildenberger. We had one who couldn't be with us tonight because she was at another music rehearsal, Skylar Jensen.
The National Merit Scholarship Program recognizes less than 1% of seniors nationwide for their exceptional scores on the PSAT test during junior year. Finalists for this competition are selected based upon their academic record, participation in school and community activities, demonstrated leadership abilities, employment, and honors awards received. Tonight, we are honored to recognize Jamestown's Ryan Monteith for being named a 2016 National Merit Finalist. Ryan, please join us up front, and congratulations on this wonderful accomplishment. This year, 4 WJCC students competed in the PTA Reflections Program at the state level, and 2 of those students advanced to the national competition. Through the Reflections Program, Thousands of students create original works of art in the categories of dance choreography, film production, music composition, literature, photography, and visual arts. Students, as your name is called, please come up front to be recognized for your outstanding accomplishments and remain on stage so that we can get a group photo. From Jamestown, Grayson Arthur received an award of merit in photography. War Hills' Amelia Jacobs received an award of excellence in dance choreography. From Hornsby, Grace Galindo received an outstanding interpretation award in literature. And also from Hornsby, Heather Herrick received an Outstanding Interpretation Award in Film Production. I might add also that both Grace and Heather have advanced to the national level of the competition, and we wish them well. Congratulations. Lafayette High School athletes recently earned state recognition and titles. Students, as your name is called, please come forward and remain for a group photo. The following students were named to the 2016 Virginia High School League All-State Swim and Dive Team. Jenna Biotti, also for the 500 freestyle state champion. Jessica Biotti, also 200 medley relay state champion. Maya Coffey. Lynn Chrissy. Connor Flannery. Emma Freiling. Emma also for the 200 medley relay state champion. Henry Gaston. Tawny Hatcher, also for the 200 medley relay state champion. And Chris Castelny. Last but not least, Grace Olson, also for the 200 medley relay state champion. In addition, several students, hang on. Sorry. In addition, several students were named to the 2016 Virginia High School League All-State Indoor Track Team. Once again, if I call your name, please come forward. Derek Abson. Alexis Brenda A. Brandis. Serenity Chavez. Thank you. Hendricks. Audrey Hurley. Delaney Savage. Sean Smith. Conrad Steck. And Michael Tyler, who was also the high jump state champion. Three students were named to the Virginia High School League All-State Forensics Team. Julia Ball. Joanne Owens. And Astrid Stanley. Chair, this concludes recognitions for this evening, and we certainly will have more recognitions at the regular meeting in May.
Yeah, I'm always the vice chair and chair.
Thank you, Dr. Constantino. Always great to recognize our students and their accomplishments. That brings us to 7.01, citizens' comments. Dr. Beers?
At this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the school board, those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. When a speaker's name is called, the speaker comes to the podium and states his or her name for the record and directs his or her comments to the chair of the board. In order to promote a listening and respectful environment, please avoid applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstration when the speaker is addressing the school board. Personnel matters are not considered in public meetings. The school board requests that all speakers refrain from any reference to speaker-specific individuals in any form or fashion. The school board's role is to listen to the speaker rather than to respond to his or her comments. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes to make his or her comments. The school board asks each speaker to respect this time limitation, and time may not be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My directions are concluded.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. We have 11 speakers tonight, but we're going to, for the indulgence of the board, we'll maintain 3 minutes per speaker. It could take us, potentially take us over 30 minutes, but we're going to be fine. Mrs. Cook.
Absolutely. Vivian Bland.
Chairman Kelly, other members of the Williamsburg-James City School Board, and Dr. Constantino. Good evening. My name is Vivian Brown Bland, and I reside at 8504 Ashington Way in James City County. I was a student at Bruton Heights School during Mr. Raul Bird's tenure as superintendent of the Williamsburg-James City County Schools, and I remember well the effects of his discriminatory educational policies on me and other students. Ralph Waldo Emerson said, "The secret of education lies in respecting the pupil. It is not for you to choose what he shall know, what he shall do." Mr. Bird did not respect black students. He tried in many ways to control what we would know and what we would do, including our aspirations to excel academically and to pursue professional careers. For example, when I was in the 11th grade, my government class participated in a school-wide citizenship education project. We surveyed the offerings of some of the area's social institutions. While there were many inequities, we focused on the educational offerings. We invited Mr. Bird to meet with our class. I asked the superintendent why Matthew Whaley offered its students three foreign languages while Bruton Heights offered none. Mr. Bird said, "When we learned to speak English, we would get a foreign language." And today, I recall clearly what I had to do to make up for not having had a foreign language in high school. After graduating from Bruton Heights, I enrolled in Hampton Institute, now Hampton University. I majored in English education, and one of the requirements was a foreign language. A classmate from Mississippi, yes, Mississippi, agreed to tutor me in French. I went on to achieve at Hampton and graduated with high honors. After teaching for several years, I attended the College of William and Mary and earned a Master's of Education degree. Sadly, I was not the only student whose college years were adversely affected by Mr. Bird's discriminatory policies. Students who planned medical careers had to obtain tutors, take remedial courses, and spend an extraordinary amount of time studying to make up for their deficits. So I appeal to you, the Williamsburg-James City School Board, to change the name of the Rawls Bird Elementary School to one that is appropriate to its stated mission, which is to create lifelong learners, independent thinkers, and responsible citizens.
Thank you, Mrs. Bland.
Thank you, sir.
Edith Hurd, please.
Good evening, members. I'm Edith Hurd, and I've asked myself this question a lot. Why change the name of Rawls Bird School? Have you thought about it? Sure. And I'm sure you want to know what we want to change it to. We must change the school's name because Rawls Bird was a very arrogant man. He believed in separations of the race. Bird stated at one of the black PTA meetings that he could visualize white teachers teaching black students, but not black teachers teaching white students. The Bird vision has been kept alive and well since 1950, even today, 2016. School board, ask yourself this question. How many core classes do blacks teach in our school system? Blacks have very few. It's sort of like 0.5. We have a black principal now at Rawls Bird. has taken a long time to get one. She was just made principal 2 years ago. Why? Bird's vision is still alive, and we need to change it. One of the things I'd like to ask this board tonight, how would you like for your children to attend the Nat Turner Elementary School? And perhaps you all might not even know Nat Turner. But I could justify him having his name on the school because he was a fighter for his freedom, along with being considered a murderer. Bird is not the person I would want my grandkids to explain why they went to that school. And there was a time in Williamsburg we said we would not name schools after people. But somewhere that changed. So I'm asking the board, if possible, to please make some changes because we, the blacks in this community, wanted to, never had enough power to do it, and we don't have the power now because if you look at the board, who's going to represent us? So let's make that decision on behalf of your community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Hurd.
Ethel Hill.
Chairman Kelly, members of the board, thanks for this opportunity. I'm going to read a letter which has been sent from the president of the NAACP, Williamsburg, James City, York County, and I'd like those people who are here from the NAACP to please stand. This is the letter. In a recent article in the Virginia Gazette, members of the African American community called for the renaming of Rawls Bird Elementary School due to a pattern of racist behavior toward African Americans by Mr. Bird, who was a long-term superintendent of Williamsburg James City County Schools. This letter is submitted by York James City Williamsburg NAACP in support of the call for renaming. It is clear that there are at least two views of Mr. Bird and his tenure as superintendent in the Williamsburg James City County Schools. One, as a leader who really shaped the schools currently that we have, and another known today as an avowed segregationist who could visualize whites teaching blacks, but not blacks teaching whites. According to former students and teachers, Bird took every opportunity to demean and make racially insensitive comments to black students and parents, reportedly even threatening the jobs of some parents whose children were involved in desegregating local schools, and the jobs of African American teachers who might encourage their students to consider attending white schools. There is not much documentation about Mr. Bird's racist practices, only the oral history of those who experienced it firsthand. However, according to researchers of the Lemon Project at the College of William and Mary, who interviewed many former Bruton Heights students, the same story of racial bias kept emerging across the interviews, and these stories should not be discounted. Several members of our local NAACP branch have recounted similar stories telling a disturbing pattern of racist behavior. In the 1960s, it may have seemed appropriate to name a school after a retired school superintendent, but perpetuating the legacy of racism and social injustice is no longer acceptable, particularly in the light of inclusive policies the school division holds currently today. It seems inappropriate to have a school bear the name of a man who never supported black and white children sitting side by side in the same classroom. Given the intense reaction for former students and teachers who experienced this injustice, the York James City County Williamsburg local NAACP strongly urges the school board to remove this symbol of racial injustice and rename Rawls Bird Elementary School at the earliest convenience. This is signed by our branch president. It was sent and signed before, but if anyone wants copies, I do have some.
Thank you, Mrs. Hill.
Thank you.
Kim Hunley.
Good evening, how are you? Once again, it was nice to see all the children up here, and they were highlighted for all their different arts. And so tonight we're kind of going to put you all on display. And I always, when I come in here, I try not to sit near the cameras because, you know, your facial expressions pick up everything. But this is a very stressful time. I understand that as a teacher as well. You know, we just have to inhale and breathe. And so today, Karen and I have for board members a little stress relief for you. So I know that this for me, like if you want to pop something,
my gosh,
you know, just go ahead and have at it. But definitely there's some stress relief even in this as you get through the popping. But I just wanted you all to remember that, you know, you all are on public television, and just to breathe, smile, like Mr. Kelly. I call him Sunshine because he's just always just smiling. So that's what I see when I sit back there, and I just wanted to give you a little bit of stress relief and say this too shall pass, and we are too blessed to be stressed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Hunley.
Lafayette Jones, Jr.
Ladies and gentlemen and attendees, greeting on behalf of the Bruton Heights School alumni. As indicated by our initial request for time on your agenda, we have been addressing our desire to rename Rawls Byrd Elementary School and the rationale for this request. Let me preface my comments by saying, everything we say or think has the potential to either harm or heal. Our words can destruct or construct, be positive or negative. As a single individual, we may be powerless to change the world, but we can change ourselves. And we can make a choice to pass on negativity or positivity in our speech and conduct. Our words do matter, they are strong. Now, Mr. Rawls Byrd was an individual who was selective in the use of his words, which were usually negative when directed at non-whites. Mr. Byrd was a staunch racist who avidly supported the concept of racial separation, segregation, and the false belief that non-whites were mentally inferior to white people. He had no compunction about belittling non-whites and attempting to control their actions through intimidation and verbal threats. I know this to be true because I had an encounter with him in 1960 when I applied for enrollment at the then all-white James Blair High School, which was located across the street from my home on Ironbound Road. At that time, Rawls Byrd was superintendent of schools for the Williamsburg-James City County School System. My initial contact at James Blair was with the school principal, who immediately telephoned Mr. Byrd. I was placed in a small room, isolated, and told to wait until Mr. Byrd would arrive. Now, at 17 years of age, all sorts of thoughts went through my mind as to what might happen to me in this room by myself without my parents even knowing that I was there. Now, I waited in that room for what seemed like a long time. And after Mr. Byrd arrived at the school, he immediately started questioning me as to why I wanted to transfer to James Blair. He also wanted the names of any and all teachers from Bruton Heights that had persuaded me to apply. During the questioning, he asked me several times if any of the teachers or staff at Bruton Heights had anything to do with my decision. Eventually, he told me that if I persisted in applying for the transfer, I, along with my friends, would not graduate because he would shut down both schools if necessary before he would allow a Negro to attend a white school while he was superintendent. Later that day, he called an emergency meeting of the Bruton Heights teachers and staff. He closed the school that afternoon, sent the children home, and had this immediate meeting with the staff, at which time he issued the same threats to them. Now, when my father came home from work that afternoon, he received a phone call from Mr. Byrd, and they became engaged in a heated conversation. According to my father, who was a self-employed carpenter, Mr. Byrd threatened to disrupt his employment in the county if I did not withdraw my application.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. Can you have your comments to the clerk so that he can get those to the entire board?
Sure.
I appreciate that.
Can I just give my quick summary? Take maybe 1 minute?
You're past your time.
One minute.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Thank you, though.
Okay, thank you.
Emma Magda.
Hello, my name is Emma Magda, and I was bullied at Claire Bird Baker Elementary School, and I am now at a new school called Providence Classical School, and I now am stressed because I'm scared that my sisters are not safe, and I miss my friends, and it's hard making new friends at a new school, and no one ever said sorry to me I got bullied, and they. I have new friends, but it's hard making new friends. And now, as the SOL testing is coming up at the public schools, I'm glad that my sisters are not going to be there next year because I know they'll be safer at the new.
Thank you, Ms. Magda.
Sandra Magda.
Asking for months to come. ...4,400 students kill themselves in the United States every year because they've been bullied. There was a bullied student killed themselves from York County the other day, hung himself. In another state last week, a student hung herself at school. Bullying is a serious issue. It isn't about schoolyard taunting, touching a student. It's the emotional abuse that other children inflict upon their peers. Those three reasons are the reason my husband and I have been here. Because when your daughter comes home and she cries, and profusely apologizes to her sisters to forgive her, because she feels she's left them behind. And not one of you has done anything. I get emails, which I wrote all over, from Stephanie Boudin, talking about how they, this is probably my favorite part, as our attorneys too, where it says, they will no longer communicate regarding the issues described in your attorney's November 4th letter, as well as your attorney's communications to our attorney from earlier this month. And as I listen to these wonderful people talk about how they were treated, that lives on in WJCC. I could list the retribution our family has suffered. The directing of our phone calls, a manually removed emails from the WJCC server. My husband is an engineer. He knows all about it. Looked at the bottom of the email that bounces back to me when I write to teachers all the time. Our email address has been manually removed from the WJCC server. I have two children at the school. You may have gotten rid of the problem at Claire Bird Baker. And there was no joy in our home when I found that out, because nobody wins. Nobody won. I have a daughter who saw her principal over there when we walked in and jumped from the front to the back and hid behind us. She is terrified. And we're not sitting around not taking care of it. We sent her to school whole, kindergarten, first, second, and third. And you sent her home broken. And nobody cares. Not one of you care.
Thank you, Ms. Magda.
You're welcome. That's the first thank you I want you to know. My husband likes to bring, goes, do you know they never thank you when you get done? I said, they probably don't have anything to thank me for. So I appreciate at least one thank you.
Yeah, that was not exactly true. Okay.
No, it's true. Let's
go. Jessica O'Brien, please.
Good evening. My name is Jessica O'Brien. I'm the president of All Together, which is a local community group that works to bring people together across racial lines. I'd like to endorse the request to change the name of Rawlsbird Elementary so that it doesn't valorize a man who ardently supported segregation and who felt justified in his position of superintendent of schools to demean African-American students, parents, and teachers to their faces. These are members of our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. O'Brien.
William Tose. Did I get that right? Did I say that correctly, sir? Thank you.
Mr. Kelly, school board members, Dr. Constantino. This letter is in support of the recognized change that should occur in renaming of Rawlsburg Elementary School. It's important that we take a close look at Rawlsburg and what he stood for as it reflects on the equal education of all of our students. A great superintendent has a clear vision of the district and sets goals, vision, and objectives for the district. He then sees that the goals are achieved by all teachers and students. Diversity is embraced and respected. Clearly, this was not an attribute that Rawlsburg embraced in his day-to-day practices. One would just have to look at the meetings that he had with teachers and other civic groups and organizations stating that he could not see any scenario where black teachers could be trusted with teaching of white students. A great superintendent is an effective communicator. He must take a concerted effort to communicate the needs and accomplishments of all students and teachers in a variety of platforms through written reports, communication with the media, public meetings, attending school events. These platforms are needed to promote diversity and to send a clear message that all students and teachers have value. This was not articulated in any platform under Rawlsburg's tenure. A great superintendent is a good manager. He directs administrators to accomplish the goals of the district, monitor their progress, and evaluate their performance. Clearly, Rawlsburg was divisive and did not value the performance of black educators nor black students under his jurisdiction. This was never more evident when the black children had to use the hand-me-down materials from white students. Not at any level could this leadership produce a positive respect for learning, for the learning environment. A great superintendent is a good listener. He must listen and take into account the different viewpoints of a various constituency and then make the best decision inclusive rather than exclusive. Exclusion was the common practice as it relates to Mr. Byrd's policies. A great superintendent is not afraid to take risks or make commitments. Rawlsburg said on many occasions that he would resign before he would see whites and blacks being taught by whites and blacks in his school division. It is time for the school division to rectify this injustice of naming Rawlsburg School after Mr. Rawlsburg. We must find a name that is reflective of equal education and respect for all of our students.
Thank you, Mr. Tosa.
Dr. John Whitley.
Good evening. Sometime in the mid-60s, I met Rawls Byrd. He was a racist bully. Trust me, he did not operate in a vacuum. He had the blessings and support of the school board. I discovered later that Rawls Byrd and Williamsburg Public Schools were not unique. In 1971, I was the first ever supervisor of school desegregation services for the Virginia Department of Education under grants from the federal government, the Office of Civil Rights. The state gave no money to that office at all. For 10 years, I traveled across the Commonwealth to support civil rights in public education through technical assistance and training. I saw and heard the devastating impact of racism on black folk in education. Shot at? Yeah, I was. Cursed? Yeah, I was. Discouraged? Often. Quit? Never. Hopeful? Always. If only the internal and external damage created by racism could be removed from mind and bodies of folk, and its impact on well-being, respect, and dignity reversed as easily as removing a sign from a building, if only. Unfortunately, it can't. But it is a clear statement of commitment to correcting. Racism is a constant and ever-present reality, not just relegated to past people, places, actions, and times, but alive and damnably well today, sadly. I think you, the WJCC School Board, should capture this moment of cleansing and initiate and implement policies and procedures to make certain WJCC Schools is anti-racist and multicultural from the classroom to the boardroom and all stops in between. It's going to take intentional acts and unconditional commitment. It will require watchful presence and involvement of all. I pledge my support. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Whitley.
Ben Ming Zhang.
Good evening, Mr. Chair and members of the school board. My name is Ben Ming Zhang. I am a senior at William & Mary and also a homeowner in the city. I'm here tonight to speak in favor of amending the namesake of Rawls Byrd Elementary School. While former Superintendent Byrd dedicated his life to the Williamsburg James City County School District, evidence resurfacing of his conduct towards others means that we should reconsider how displaying his name on one of our elementary schools reflects on this community and what kind of lesson it teaches students who come across under that sign every day. I am a first generation Chinese American. When my family first moved to our neighborhood in Long Island, we were very different from all the others. I was only 7 years old at the time, but I noticed that I looked strange compared to every other one of my new neighbors. The move was already rough on my mom, dad, and me, but it became even worse when one day we noticed a note lying on our doorstep which read, "Go back to China," calling us a hurtful racial slur, which I will not repeat. The memory sticks with me today because from that point on, I felt unwelcome whenever I passed someone in my neighborhood. I cannot imagine having to be reminded of such hateful rhetoric every day when I walk into school. Although students at the school may not yet understand, I guarantee that they will at some point. They will understand that they have attended a school which promoted an individual who refused to shake another man's hand because of their skin color. They will understand that they wore the name of a racist man on their shirts when trying to have school pride. And they will understand that no one did anything about it. Now, I will leave you with this. The mission statement of the Rawls Byrd Elementary states that it values partnership with the community. Superintendent Byrd, however, only valued partnerships with a single part of the community, the part which looked like him. By refusing to treat African Americans as equal members of the community, Rawls Byrd's actions did not reflect the mission of the Williamsburg James City County School System. This is why the name of that school must be changed, so we can move on past the time where diversity was frowned upon and progress towards a more inclusive Williamsburg. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you for all the citizens' comments today. That takes us to our consent agenda, 8.01, approval of minutes from the following meetings, March 1st, 2016, and March 15th,
2016, 8.02 financial report and monthly bills and payroll. March 2016, 8.03 personnel actions. 8.04 resolution R1116, National Teacher Appreciation Week. 8.05 retire policy GBCA staff conflict of interest. 8.06 revision recode policy ILA to policy IL testing programs. And 8.07 revision policy IFA educational research. Can I have a motion?
Chairman, I move to accept the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second? Any discussion? Ms. Serza, can you take the vote, please?
Yes. Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 9.01, can I have a motion for purchase of four school buses in the amount of $433,748 from Sunny Merriman Incorporated?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of action item 9.01, purchase of four school buses in the amount of $433,748 from Sunny Merriman Incorporated.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? We talked about this just last week. It's been moved and seconded for purchase of four school buses in the amount of $433,748 from Sunny Merriman Incorporated. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. That takes us to 9.02. Have a motion for authorization of purchase of materials for high school refresh in the amount of $810,850 to electronic systems and transfer of funds from instructional services cost center to technology cost center.
Mr. Chair, I move approval of item 9.02, authorization of purchase of materials for high school refresh in the amount of $810,850 to electronic systems and a transfer of funds from instructional services cost center to the technology cost center.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for authorization of purchase of materials for high school refresh in the amount of $810,850 to electronic systems and transfer of funds from instructional services cost center to technology cost center. Ms. Serza?
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 9.03, can I have a motion for award of contract for invitation for bid number 16-8330? Partial demolition of James Laird Middle School to Richie Kerbo in the amount of $1,106,742.
Mr. Chair, I move approval of item 9.03, award a contract for invitation for bid number 16-8330, partial demolition of James Blair Middle School to Richie Kerbo in the amount of $1,106,742.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's been moved and seconded to award a contract for invitation for bid number 16-8330, partial demolition of James Laird Middle School to Richie Kerbo in the amount of $1,106,742. Mrs. Cook, I'm sorry, Mrs. Serza, begins with a C.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
No.
Mrs. Young?
No.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. Brings us to 9.04. Can I have a motion for award invitation for bid number 16-8685, James River Elementary School roof replacement to Star LLC in the amount of $636,700.
Mr. Chairman, I move action item 9.0 for the award of contract for invitation bid 16-8685, James River Elementary roof replacement.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hold on 1 second. Mr. Snipes. I noticed in the tabulation form there was only one bid received for this.
Correct. There was only one bid from Starburst.
Do you know how many invitations for bid were sent out? To that,
We do not know how many invitations were sent out, but they were issued on the James City County Bulletin Board and placed on the James City County and Williamsburg.
They were publicly posted.
Publicly posted.
Do we have any understanding? Is two questions. Do we have an understanding as to why no one else proposed? And two, how do I know I'm getting a good price here?
We do not have any indication of why others didn't submit a bid. It could be, you know, they didn't have the business right then. They didn't have the amount for the bonds. It could have been a number of different issues. As regards to if you're getting the best price for what we're doing, we actually budgeted $641,000 for this project through an architect. So it's coming in right at or under budget.
So we had an architect. What's the company's name?
RRMM.
They estimated this for us. Put this put $641,000 in our budget to cover that. This is below that budgeted number.
It is below that budgeted number, and I believe Ms. Bird, if she would she like to comment, we did transfer some funds to assist with this.
Now, my concern is just to make sure that we understand that we're getting best value, and that's just my concern. So we had an estimate or below that estimate, so we have reasonable expectation that we're getting
that is correct.
Best value. Any other board member comments? I will tell you that we just have a little, I personally have a little trepidation with just one bidder.
I share that concern.
So. But James River needs a new roof, right? So it's been moved and seconded for award invitation for bid number 168685 to James River Elementary School roof replacement to Starburst Construction LLC in the amount of $636,700. Ms. Cerza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. That takes us to 9.5. Can I get a motion for award invitation for bid number 168679, Jamestown High School roof replacement to Roof Engineering Corporation in the amount of $731,180.
Mr. Chairman, I move action item 9.05, award of a contract for invitation for bid 168679, Jamestown High School roof replacement.
Your second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Young.
My question is, how is there a guarantee from, the individual roofing companies as to how long the roof will last?
Roofing warranties are based upon the type of roof that is installed. And so on this roof, it's a shingle roof, and there are 20-year warranty on those. So.
Ms. Meyer?
So this roof is going to be a 20-year roof as opposed to the 15 we had on it?
This, usually shingle roofs are about 20 years for these, yes.
And that was all in the specification for bid, that there'd be a shingle roof and a 20-year life expectancy?
Yes, it's a 15 to 20-year life expectancy, but we expect to get 20 years out of those, yes.
15 to 20 years, so 15 is the warranty period, and then 20 is how long we expect it to last, or do we know?
20 years is the useful life, yes.
Okay. Any other board member questions? It's been moved and seconded to award an invitation for bid number 168679, Jamestown High School roof replacement to Roof Engineering Corporation, the amount of $731,180. Ms. Cerza?
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Takes us to 9.06. Can I get a motion to award a contract for invitation for bid number 168805, Clara Bird Baker Elementary School refurbishment and security vestibule improvements to Oyster Point Construction in the amount of $1,496,482.
Mr. Mr. Chair, I move approval of item 9.06, award a contract for invitation for bid number 16-8805, Clara Bird Baker Elementary School refurbishment and security vegetable improvements to Oysterport construction in the amount of $1,496,482.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Mr. Snipes, could you just do me a favor and explain to the audience and what we're getting for $1,496,000?
Yes, the scope of work for the project includes replacement of floor finishes, paint finishes, and ceiling tiles, replacement and upgrade of interior lighting, installation of aluminum storefront system to provide a secure vestibule area at the main entrance, and the replacement of select plumbing fixtures, which was an add alternate, and also the installation of acoustical wall panels, which also was an add alternate.
Okay, so it's more of a school refurbishment than it is a security vestibule.
Yes, it is more of a security. It's more of a school refurbishment than a security vestibule. We included the security vestibule along with the refurbishment because it's easier and more efficient to do one all at the same time.
And can you remind me how many bids we had for this project?
Yes, we had a total of three bids for this project.
Any other board members have any comments? It's been moved and seconded for award of contract for invitation for bid number 16-8805, Clara Bird Baker Elementary School refurbishment and security vestibule improvements to Oyster Point construction in the amount of $1,496,482. Ms. Cerza?
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Brings us to 9.07. Can I get a motion for award invitation for bid number 16-8686, Clara Bird Baker Elementary School roof replacement to Roof Engineering Corporation in the amount of $68,917.
Mr. Chair, I move approval of item 9.07, award invitation for bid number 16-8686, Clara Bird Baker Elementary School roof replacement to Roof Engineering Corporation in the amount of $68,917.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion?
Mr. Chair, I noticed that there's a vast difference between this and the awards. I think this was discussed during our last meeting that this is because they're only roofing a part of the school. Am I remembering right?
You are correct. I believe you can see it on your screen, I believe. The area that is shaded over in the yellow is the area that's being replaced. It is the addition that was added in 1992. That is what is being replaced, the roof in that area.
I have a question.
Someone?
This is just kind of a general question. How come the Clara Bird Baker replacement roof gets 11 vendors to respond and the James River one only gets one? Is it a different kind of roof? Is it?
It could be the timing of when the bids go out. I believe this bid went out in January, and the other one, the Clara Bird Baker, the James River. James River also went out in January. It could be a number of different reasons. We do not know. It could be based on if the vendor can do the work at the time. Sometimes they have work that is being done at the time, they cannot take on any additional work. So it could be a number of different reasons. We don't inquire on why we don't get a number of bids.
Seems like it's curious to me why there's like 11 for one and one for another, and if there is some kind of a better time of year, I have no idea.
I'm going to ask Mr. Robertson.
All right, you don't have to. He's right behind you.
I'm just curious.
I appreciate all the questions about number of bidders. Believe me, we're as frustrated about that sometimes as you are when we get one and wonder what happened. Just so you know, when we get it, we always go out and ask questions. I'll call the architect and say, "Is there anything in the specs?" Because specs can do that. If you have someone who's looking at specs and it's confusing or not as clear, you might not get some. I think in this case, if you look at it, because it's a much smaller project, I think it could appeal to a different type of contractor. When you're thinking of replacing, you know, many, many more square footage on Jamestown or James River, that requires a larger company. And I think that's part of it, but it's a mystery. I know that we were asked a question about sometimes does it make a difference whether it's earlier in the year or not. And it does. We try to get things out in February as late as, that's about as late as we like to get, because if it's a summer project, people fill up their agenda. They're busy. They've already got jobs, and they're not as eager to get the work. But it used to be a number of years ago with the economy a little bit tighter. On every project we submitted, we had 10 vendors. It's just starting to change in the past year that we see it tightening up a little bit. And it's hard to figure out. I wish we could cut it down to as simple as what month we bid it, because that would make it easier on us.
Thank you. Any other questions? And looking at these bids, roof engineering is significantly lower than the other bidders. Are we comfortable with their ability to perform on this and that?
Yes, we're comfortable with it. We've used roof engineering in the past on a smaller project, but yes, we're comfortable with their bid and their proposal.
I do have one question. When there's such variance in the 11 responses, do we ever like take the outliers, like the lowest and the highest, because there really are, there's such discrepancy between them, and then look at, because when we look at the others, they really are more representative of each other?
Well, an IFB is based on cost alone, not based on the proposal, on what they're doing. We already know what we want it done, and so an IFB is really based primarily on cost.
So they made the insurances that they could
do.
Okay, thank you.
We had $93,000 budgeted for this?
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions? It's been moved and seconded for award invitation for bid number 168686, Clara Bird Baker Elementary School Roof Replacement to Roof Engineering Corporation in the amount of $68,917. Ms. Cerza?
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. That brings us to 10.01, information item, project update on the high school redesign planning grant. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. In July 2015, our school division was awarded one of five planning grants in the Commonwealth to reconceptualize and redesign high school experiences for students. Together with William & Mary School of Education, as well as the Mason School of Business, planning has been ongoing for about a year, and since that time to launch a pilot program in the fall of 2016. Attached to your agenda item this evening, before I turn the presentation over to others, you will see a letter dated April 5th from State Superintendent of Public Instruction, Dr. Staples. And in that letter, while I won't read the letter to you, I would point out, first of all, his commending our commitment, your commitment, and our commitment in securing one of the grants. Also, our commitment to deliver the very best high school experiences that we can deliver. And also, our role going forward as being a leader in the state that others may look to. Dr. Staples and the State Board of Education are very interested in gathering ideas and then growing this idea so that high school education in the Commonwealth is different in the future than what it is today. So I just wanted to make sure that you saw that letter and know that we are on solid ground with the State Superintendent and the Board of Education. There's a number of people here this evening that have been involved in this work. Everyone listed under your data source. I'd like to welcome this evening Dr. Mark Hofer and Dr. Lindy Johnson, both from the William & Mary School of Education, who have been instrumental in the Center for Innovation in Learning to help us conceptualize this pilot, and also will explain a little bit about how they will help us evaluate our efforts. So without any further ado, I'll turn it over to Dr. Carroll. Are you up first? Dr. Carroll will make some, and this is an introductory, kind of an overview for you. There'll be a few people that will share different portions of the presentation for you this evening, including our colleagues from the college. Dr. Carroll.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the school board, Dr. Constantino, and other guests. My name is Jeff Carroll, and I'm the principal of War Hill High School. As Dr. Constantino said, last spring, Governor McAuliffe and the General Assembly challenged school divisions to think outside the box and develop non-traditional approaches to instruction, measurement of content mastery, and school governance by offering five $50,000 high school innovation planning grants. These grants allow grant recipients to enact their own specifically designed program free from the usual regulations imposed on school divisions. Each plan was developed so that it can be potentially replicated by other school divisions with minimal costs. Williamsburg James City County Public Schools, in partnership with the School of Education at the College of William & Mary, received one of the five grants based upon curricular and structural innovations at War Hill High School that promote self-directed learning projects, flexible pacing, and student autonomy. Tonight, we are here to update you on the Pathways Project at War Hill. In our current high school model, students earn letter grades and typically receive diplomas, even though they may not have truly mastered the content. As a result, many students entering post-secondary institutions are required to take remedial courses, which increase the time and expense of pursuing post-secondary options by increasing the amount of courses needed. Transitioning away from seat time in favor of a structure that creates flexibility allows students to progress as they demonstrate mastery of academic content, regardless of time, place, or pace of learning. Students who are able to excel, accelerate, and students who need additional resources, receive them. Such a system enables both high flyers and students with large learning gaps to accelerate. Competency-based strategies provide flexibility in the way that credits can be earned or awarded, and provide students with personalized learning opportunities. These strategies include online and blended learning, dual enrollment and early college high school options, project-based and community-based learning, and credit recovery, among others. This type of learning leads to better student engagement because the content is relevant to each student and tailored to their unique needs. It also leads to better student outcomes because the pace of learning is customized to each student. In addition, assessment becomes meaningful and serves as a positive learning experience for each student. Students receive timely, differentiated support based on their individual learning needs. The first component of the Pathways Project we call Highways. Highways consist of five components. They are design your roadmap, design your on-ramp, humanities by design with Pathways English, physics by design with Pathways Math. And at this time, I'm going to explain each of those components. Design your roadmap. This experience is a week-long boot camp prior to the start of school. During this week of experiential learning, students will be introduced to four guideposts of pathways: design thinking, project-based learning, online learning, and 21st century skills. They also will get to know their fellow travelers and guides. Design your on-ramp. Students work independently and collaboratively work with community members in real-world exploration of career options that align with their personal interests and skills while also working to determine themselves as learners. Upon completion of the course, students will have developed a personalized plan that is a culmination of their self-reflection of their own strengths, their exploration of various career options, and the educational experiences necessary to meet their own learning goals. Humanities by design. This course will encourage and enable students to participate in sustained collaborative inquiry within a global context. Students will reflect upon the orientations of humanities topics in space and time and produce genuine solutions to real-world issues on community, national, and global scales. Physics by design. This course utilizes mathematics, science, and technology as tools through which we can understand and interact with the physical and digital worlds in an effort to build conceptual understandings and 21st century skills. This applied physics course will develop mathematical literacy in algebra and trigonometry and introduce key concepts of physics through a series of open-ended, real-world projects. Student success in developing a final project will hinge on applying concepts of energy, projectile motion, circuits, and fluid dynamics, while supporting design decisions with right-angle trigonometric functions, exponents, error analysis, and statistics. Design your career. Students will select an introductory course from a possible career interest area. This course will ready students with the knowledge and skills that will be needed in the potential career field. All components of Highways will incorporate design thinking, project-based learning, online learning, and 21st century skills. Upon completion of these mile markers, students will be ready to travel further along their pathway. As I have mentioned, one of the guideposts of Pathways is design thinking. I would like to ask one of our William & Mary partners, Associate Professor Mark Hoffer, to further explain design thinking and its role with Pathways.
Thank you, Dr. Carroll and Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'd like to convey how our enthusiasm at the college for this partnership, to be invited to be a part of this experience, and what a really energizing and creative partnership it's been in collaboration. So Dr. Carroll mentioned that design thinking was one of the pillars of the project. That was actually something that came to us, as Dr. Constantino mentioned, in conversations with faculty in the Mason School of Business. This is a creative problem-solving model that is very human-centered approach, so building on a careful definition of a problem, understanding, empathizing with your clients to solve complex problems and take advantage of opportunities. This was interesting because we used this in our initial phases to devise the different pillars that Dr. Carroll just mentioned, but actually it was such an energizing and productive experience for those of us working to develop these ideas that we realized the power it would have in the courses with the students in the Pathways Project at War Hill as well. So this has become not just part of our process for imagining what high school could be for these students, but also the kinds of experience we want to engage those students in as well. One of the best ways maybe to think about design thinking is as there are many different creative problem-solving models. This is an interesting one, though, because it's a very iterative model. So the idea is you come up with solutions to problems, ideas to capitalize on opportunities, quickly move to getting feedback from the community, from people, the stakeholders of that process, trying them out, revising those ideas, and learning from it as you go. And so one way to think about it is as a piece of a puzzle. So this is a very complex project, as you're probably getting a sense of already, with a lot of different parts. So one strength of the design thinking methodology is to be able to zero in on any one part of that project and really think through how to put it into place, how to operationalize our ideas, test it out, then go back to the next phase of the process. So that iterative nature and formative feedback really was very helpful as we've developed where we are today. And finally, just want to share, some of you, I think maybe all of you, were at the screening last week of the Most Likely to Succeed film. Ted Dintersmith is a very interesting alum of William & Mary. I think the first, and I don't know if only, but the first double major that completed honors projects in physics and English. So a very interesting person, and has become a venture capitalist, very interested in education. And he's created this film to provide a vision for what school, in particular high school, could be for students to prepare them for careers that we don't even know exist today, what their futures and not our past. So Ted argues that schools of the futures will be about critical skills and not subjects, mastery over memorization, the world and not worksheets, self-direction, not hoop navigation, and purpose, not placement. So that film, going back to the homecoming weekend in October when we screened it originally in the School of Education, and then rescreened it again last week, really provided some vision and some ideas for thinking about the students that this project would serve, what their needs are, and how we might engage them as learners. And I think that's the next part of our presentation.
Hi, I'm Kat Wargo. I'm the English curriculum leader at War Hill High School, and I've been extremely excited to be a part of this process. So as Mark said, this is about the students. So let's look at a few students that might go through this program. We have Lauren, Justin, and Shelley. All three students identify health sciences as a career cluster they want to pursue. Each student acquires workplace readiness skills during the Construct Your On-Ramp, and each completes Principles of Biomedical Science as the Health Science Readiness course. Each completes all early high school requirements. So the second component of our program we call expressways. So once they've completed the highway mile markers, they have five options. Those are AP, which happens on site, and dual enrollment, which they would do virtually. Concurrent enrollment, as well as early college, traditional coursework, and complete a locally scored portfolio. They can do career studies certificate and an internship, or they could do an apprenticeship and industry credentials. So Lauren decides she wants to be a doctor and chooses expressway number one. Her goal is to attend a competitive four-year college, so she needs to do rigorous course of study. She'll do AP biology, AP chemistry, human body systems, medical interventions, and biomedical innovation. Justin decides that he wants to be a paramedic and chooses expressway number two. So his goal is to complete a paramedic program at Thomas Nelson Community College, which is right next to us. His course of study is human body systems, medical interventions, and biomedical innovation. He enters early college. He does English 110, English 111, Introduction to Health Sciences, the EMT Basic and Clinical, and other required prerequisites for the paramedic program. Shelley decides she wants to be an occupational therapy aide and chooses expressway number four. She completes a course of study that includes the human body systems and biology. She, in addition, completes online coursework and an internship at the Riverside Therapy Systems. The online classes and the on-job training allow her to earn her OTA certificate. So after high school, Lauren's going to go to a four-year college. Justin will get a job in emergency medical services, and then Shelley will be an occupational therapy aide.
And then the student examples that Kat just shared use the health science career cluster as the example. The National Career Clusters Framework provides a structure for organizing and supporting career awareness. In total, there are 16 career clusters in this framework designed to help students navigate their way to greater success in post-secondary study and careers. Pathways will support all 16 career clusters as it helps students discover their interests and empowers them to choose the educational pathways that will lead to success in high school, college, and careers. The process of designing pathways has been a partnership, as we've said, between WJCC Schools and the College of William & Mary. To share this process and evaluation plans, I'd like to introduce Assistant Professor Lindy Johnson.
Hi, good evening. I just want to reiterate Dr. Hofer's comments that William & Mary has been so excited and honored to be a part of this process. One of the things that we have been tasked with is evaluating the process both during the planning grant itself and then also moving forward, really looking at both student outcomes and teacher outcomes. So just in terms of, to give you an idea of kind of what we've been doing for the past year is a lot of planning. And a lot of that planning has happened through professional development workshops with teachers. We started with a design thinking boot camp that was held at the Mason School of Business and was co-facilitated with one of our colleagues there, Graham Henshaw. And that workshop really introduced teachers and administrators to the design thinking process. We then moved in, starting in February, to designing some curriculum professional development workshops. So we've been working with the teachers to co-design the curriculum. We've also provided workshops on project-based learning and performance-based assessments. So one of the things that we think is really important as we're moving forward with this project is to evaluate the student outcomes. We anticipate, based on prior research, that we anticipate some really positive outcomes. So we are going to be looking at student engagement and motivation, and we'll be using surveys with the students to measure their engagement and motivation as they move through the program. We'll also be looking at their retention and attendance, and we hope to see improvement in both of those areas. And then we'll be looking at student learning outcomes. We'll be looking at their alternative assessment scores and standardized assessments as well, and anticipate seeing improved scores on those assessments. We're also going to be looking at the effectiveness of the program. So we're going to be looking at the professional development program and growth in teachers' abilities to teach in this kind of new way. So we will be conducting some interviews with teachers. We'll be doing self-efficacy surveys with the teachers, and we hope to see improvements in those areas. And we'll also be evaluating teachers' ability to plan and implement project-based learning. And so we're going to be conducting some observations of teachers throughout the course of the year. So I'll turn it back over to Jeff.
And then the path ahead of us. Next week, we'll update the Virginia Board of Education on this project's progress and additional site visits to discover best practices and learn implementation lessons will occur in April and May. As Dr. Johnson said, professional development in the areas of curriculum, project-based learning, and performance assessment will continue through June, and curriculum writing will continue through July. Pathways will not hold students to a predefined age cohort pace. Students will become the co-designers of their education. Pathways will connect each student's education to their own skills and interests in a way that will end in deeper learning. As a result, Pathway students will be able to think critically about what their future will be, acquire skills to navigate their future, and connect with industries and businesses, and most importantly, follow their own personal pathway. The Pathways Project at War Hill will launch in the fall of 2016 with 100 ninth grade students. Students zoned to attend any of the three high schools may apply to participate. If more than 100 students apply to participate, a lottery will determine the 100 participants. Interest meetings for students and parents will be held at all three middle schools and at War Hill High School during the month of May. At this time, I'll ask Dr. Constantino to discuss other next steps.
Thank you. Just a couple of things to help the board kind of put this all together. I take you all the way back to our strategic plan and the language in our strategic plan that talks about creating student-centered environments, creating environments in which we can do our best to individualize learning. And I don't think that's any more important than K through 12 certainly, but very important at the high school level that we engage our students and they are engaged in their own learning. So I feel as though that the project is in the strike zone of what we envisioned in 2012 when we began the strategic plan process. I also want to share with the board that we have garnered the assistance both of the superintendent's advisory group, and you know that group to be local business and industry leaders who have championed this idea, who actually wrote a letter of support for us for the initial grant application, and who've already talked to us about, you've heard apprenticeships and internships and experiences that students will need outside of our schools. We already have people coming forward saying, we would love to help you. Please engage us. So I thought that was a good thing. Secondly, I was invited to speak to the Education Committee of the Chamber. They were so excited about it that I ended up speaking to the board soon after that, and got a great deal of commitment and support from that organization also in terms of community connections and experiences for our kids. We are not expecting to expend any monies that are not budgeted. We are working within our means. I think one of the things that we heard when we applied for the grant from the state was that don't assume there'll be any extra money. And so we've never made that assumption.
It's so typical.
However, with that said, I will go out on a limb and someone will have a saw. But I have heard discussion of the availability of implementation grants for the original five districts. And if that is true, trust me, we'll be first in line to do what we have to do to accept whatever monies the state is willing to give us. But at the present time, we may be reshuffling and reorganizing, but we're not going to come back to the board and at the present time in this pilot and ask for more money. Next week's state board presentation is a very brief. We got a letter today that we have no more than 10 minutes, so we already have to shave off a lot of time. But the board has been very interested, the state board has been very interested in hearing from the five districts about the kinds of statute, the kinds of policies that the Board of Education might relax in order to allow more flexibility at the division level. And some of you know that for many years I have been championing the idea of flexibility in exchange for accountability. And I think we're finally at that doorstep where there may be the board is very friendly to opening different ideas and different aspects. You heard Dr. Carroll talk about competencies. You'll hear we already have flexibility. We did a review. One of the committees that I ran was a review of all of the state codes, all of the state regulations, to determine if we needed any waivers or deviations from state policy. And it was actually a pretty healthy experience, because what we found is that much flexibility is already written into the state code. We don't spend a lot of time reading state code. It's not fun reading. But when you do, you realize that there is already some flexibility. And this board in previous years, previous boards, have taken advantage of some of that flexibility. So with all of that said, it's a very exciting time for us. It's a lot of work. The work continues. We're by no means done. We're not going to sit back and put our feet up now. We're still working. We have a meeting tomorrow morning at 8:30, just like we've had every Wednesday since I can't remember. But we'll continue to do that work. We'll continue to put these plans in place. We will hopefully have a very successful pilot moving forward in the fall. And with that, any of the folks here will take any questions or comments that you might have.
Some?
Oh, sure. How many, you say 100 War Hill students, how many freshmen, right?
It's open to 100 rising ninth graders that are zoned for any of the three high schools.
Okay, and how many freshmen?
Typically, I mean, I currently have about 1,200, so about
250,
275.
Okay, so we're talking about like a little less than 50% of the freshman class will be participating in this.
If they're all War Hill students.
If they're War Hill students. And how do they decide? Is it a opt? Do they opt into it?
Yes. We'll have the parent meetings and student information meetings during the month of May, and if it'll be an opt-in. So we're hoping we find 100 students, and we believe in the program. I think that we will find 100 students within the school division, but. You know, it's only opt-in when families and students are comfortable with joining this program.
I applaud you for all the work that you're doing. It's not easy to innovate, and especially to innovate in a way that is mired in a little bit of bureaucracy with the state and with the SOL. I mean, just the whole thing. So I do applaud you for working and taking advantage of some of the school of ed people that are so close to us. So,
one of the things you're talking about is having students apply from the different upcoming middle schools, right? I think I have that right. They're going to be rising ninth graders, and they'll be enter the program. I mean, what happens? There's always going to be questions, but maturity at that level is not. I mean, some kids, there's going to be a huge variance in ability to focus in on this. And has maturity level been taken into consideration when thinking about this program?
I mean, I'll have them as freshmen one way or the other, so.
Well, they're going to get older, so that's the good thing.
We're hoping that, I mean, as we've talked about tonight, the ideas behind this that will increase student engagement and that it'll actually be meaningful and relevant to them and engage them no matter what their maturity level is.
And then I have two other, I mean, several questions, but would students, if they're entering in the ninth grade, would they be graduating sooner or later than their peers?
Completely be up to each individual student. It's going to be personalized.
Okay, so if I'm a ninth grader and I am very motivated and I'm going to become an EMT at the age of 16?
At all of the Virginia high school graduation requirements.
And how is that going to happen as far as credits? I mean, students are going to be designing their own learning, if I understand what you've said so far. So how are credits going to be awarded for this program?
Well, we're moving to competency. So as students meet certain competencies, we still have to award a credit. So for example, the humanities by design, we have a Virginia course code that will go with that. And that's also part of the partnership with William and Mary that they will review and credential any of those courses.
I like the idea of competency-based testing and things. I think that's a much more appropriate. And the other question, I guess, probably, which none of us have really been able to answer adequately, is what is 21st century learning? I mean, this seems to be very nebulous to me. I do understand the idea of preparing students for the 21st century, but what does it really mean?
Well, I don't think it's nebulous anymore. I don't have my notes in front of me, but you know, the Virginia Board of Education is actually, we're looking at what we call the skills of a graduate, you know, the five C's. So critical thinking, again, competencies, communication. Help me out, team.
Collaboration.
Thank you.
Creativity.
Was that five? I don't know. So, you know, as Mark talked about in the movie, Most Likely to Succeed, you know, that's the challenge that we face as educators today in the 21st century. I'm trying to prepare students each day for jobs that don't exist right now. And so what are those skills that will enable them to be successful and be able to educate and continue to acquire skills in the future throughout their career and not, you know, phase out and not be able to have a meaningful life?
Can I speak to that?
Sure.
Just quick anecdote. Yep. So I was just at the business school this morning presenting part of this project to a business school class. And one of the things that the business school professors have said that they've noticed in the last few years with No Child Left Behind is that their students are actually becoming less creative and less able to solve these complex problems. And they code, they work with, you know, these massive companies, and the companies say, we don't need a student who can pass a multiple choice test. We need a student who can come in and deal with a very complex problem, work on it with the team, and come up with some creative solutions. So these ideas of collaboration and creativity and critical thinking may seem like soft skills, but they're actually increasingly valued in the workforce. So just wanted to add that.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So, Dr. Constantino, hearkening back to the days of the strategic plan development, I had the pleasure of serving on that committee, and you're right, and I feel like we should write a letter to everybody and say, yay,
we're getting there.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm just very honored to be small part of an organization that is collaborating with a wonderful institution like the College of William & Mary, so thank you to everyone who has taken part in this. It's really quite amazing. I had the opportunity of participating in the design thinking workshop, so that was a blast, building wallets. So I still have my wallet. One day, I'll actually. But it's a real honor to be a leader in Virginia again. And you know, as always, people look to us. So this is just living up to that reputation. So I have two questions. When I enthusiastically talk about being free from some of the regulations and being flexible in exchange for accountability, can you just give the public and the board some examples? I know you just said the code was a little more flexible, but you know, when someone says, like, what? I said, I don't know.
Yeah, I'll give you a couple of mine, and then Dr. Carroll can either agree or correct me. One of the things you hear all the time is clock hours. For years and years and years, we've had this antiquated idea that for one to learn, one must sit in a seat for 100 and whatever hours it is. And I think the state board realizes and state code realizes that might not be appropriate for every student. Some students might be able to demonstrate mastery and competency in a shorter amount of time, and it might take some students a longer amount of time. It might take one student 50 hours to complete something. It might take another student 200 hours. And what we're suggesting is that there's nothing wrong with either one of those two things, that we can personalize this pathway for students so that they can take some ownership and be at the center of their own learning. That's one example. The other example I would offer is just the concept of working toward competencies toward a credit as opposed to some of the more traditional ways that we have looked at credits. And also, quite frankly, from what I have experienced firsthand in speaking with Dr. Staples and members of the state board, there's also very, very much of an interest in alternative assessments, looking at different ways to assess kids. I think we all know that the governor has put together an innovation committee. They are taking a very strong look at SOL testing. Several tests have been eliminated. There's also numerous recommendations going to be coming forward about how schools are accredited and the role of creativity in schools. I think it's energizing because for those of us who have been hanging around for education for a long time, these last 15 years have been tough years where we have seen creativity pushed off to the side, and now it's back where I think it always should have been, and that's at the center of what teachers do best and what students do best. I also think there are some things coming that we haven't imagined yet, where there might not be a requirement that we can't even conceptualize today, that, 5 or 10 years from now, there may be more things that just become obsolete. Because they no longer fit the mold. So I think we're at the cutting edge of deep space exploration in terms of where we're going. But those are a couple of examples that I can think of, and you might have some others.
And then my other question has to do with the design thinking framework and empathizing with the client. And at the end of the day, the student is the client. So I'm curious if you can talk a little bit about engaging students on the front end of this to inform the work that you've done.
And the role so far, or
yeah, just how we're, yeah, just if, what kind of feedback you've gotten from students to inform.
Oh, well, we've had focus groups, and I think that was something from their. Superintendent's advisory also.
The board's last spring, we had a focus group of the board's student advisory committee, and we talked to them and asked them some very direct questions about their own learning, and they gave us some very direct answers, as students will. And quite frankly, much of what they said made our initial grant application, and I even got comments back from state board members and people who had seen the grant saying, the comments that your students made about their own learning and being at the center of their own learning were very persuasive comments. So, we've gotten some good feedback, and we've learned a lot from our students already, and I suspect we'll learn a lot more.
Ms. Taylor?
I was wondering how the program is going to impact traditional testing and assessment. Do you have any insights on that to this point?
These students, we won't rely, as Dr. Constantino said, on traditional assessments for them. So we're going to look at reducing the number of assessments needed, and also trying to choose assessments that measure what they know, but also are meaningful. For example, with the humanities by design, instead of using the current English 11 SOL as the exit exam, what we're strongly considering is that we'll look at the work keys reading, which is another assessment that the state considers and allows us to use currently, but only as an alternative. But the advantage of work keys, it's also one of the entrance exams or entrance criteria for many of our community colleges. So it's giving students the option, hey, you know, we're going to take an assessment, but it's not just over here to check a box and say, I did this and I can move on. It's using an assessment. It's giving us the student feedback, us feedback. Yes, you've mastered these competencies, and now you've got something that you can use if you're applying to community college or if you're pursuing some of the other expressways that we put up here.
Okay, so it's an alternative to the SOL. Okay, thank you.
Dr. Beers?
I fully endorse this. I think it's a very exciting initiative. It reminds me of some things that have actually been going on quite a while, other parts of the world. Reading Ready for Critical Thinking was a huge international project, and that's exactly what it was all about. You start off with the premise that the amount of new information that comes in on a yearly basis, it's impossible to know all of it. So what you have to learn is how to know it and what to do it. Really excited. I have a couple of questions. One of them is, and this may actually, this may come back to something the superintendent said, but I do know something about freshman students. I guess, do you have the assumption that they all know what it is they want to do when they enter as freshmen? And if they don't,
the assumption
and if they don't, they don't. How will this kind of a program, how will that help them? Or what will you feel that, will it kind of get a smorgasbord? Can they test stuff out? Or
what's if we go back to those five components of highways, the design your on-ramp is going to be just those opportunities where we're designing that curriculum for them to learn about themselves as learners, to do career exploration, to work with a mentor and get out into the community. And if I think I'm interested in something, go spend some time, see those careers. We don't expect them to know what they want to do. And that's really one
of
our...
And then lead to... that other screen where you had 20 or so different clusters, and how will they, because they're going to need some guidance out there to be sure.
That guidance is going to occur during.
The other thing is, I am always worried about, really top programs like this, really exciting programs. Is it going to be for the best and the brightest? In other words, if you're looking at 100 kids, are you going to be swamped with those parents who really want to, or are you also going to try to reach out for maybe the less able, or they're not so motivated, or, because I would really, to me, for it to be really successful, in my mind anyway, I'd like to see opportunities for that whole spectrum of students, not just the best and the brightest, but the ones that aren't quite sure, the ones, maybe they didn't do that great in English in middle school. How are you going to control for that?
I think this program is for any student who may not feel current traditional high school engages them.
That's how you're going to do it?
It's open to all students who may want to participate in it.
They may not even know that they want to participate. That's what I'm. And usually, the lower end kids are the ones that are the most reluctant to try something new. So that's the group I'm talking about. And the other thing I do hope, and I think those clusters, to me, really pointed it out. And I hope this is true. I see an integrated curriculum here. Am I making that up, or is that part of, part of the focus or what you're trying to accomplish, so that I'm answering the question, so I'll shut up and answer the question.
So for two of those courses, yes, the humanities course is integrated English and social studies course, and the physics by design is an integrated science and math course.
Just don't forget about the lower-end kids. That's what I, because they certainly can benefit from this. It's like years ago, the only kids that got into the Great Book Series were really the brightest and the best, and we learned many years later that the lower-end kids could figure out and deal with that stuff just as effectively as the top-end kids. So that's all.
Dr. Costino.
First of all, I appreciate your question because I think it's an important question and one that we have discussed from the very beginning and one that's actually been discussed with the state board as well. I think everybody wants to make sure that this is an inclusive program. And honestly, I think we're going to have some salesmanship. I think we're going to have to go out and we go to our middle schools and talk with parents and kids. We're going to have to sell the concept and sell the idea and help parents and kids feel good about it. All kinds of parents and all kinds of kids. I don't want 100 of the best and brightest students in this program. I want a cross-section of students that are representative of our community so that we can get a good evaluation model at the end of this to determine can we truly assist students who cross the spectrum. So I think it's an extremely valid question. We are working on our public relations program and kind of marketing and selling, and there are, you know, we'll be out in the middle schools and doing our very best. And if we see, and I'm going to go out into speculation land at the moment, but if we see that the interest is coming from one particular group, that's just going to have to redouble our efforts to go out and champion this idea with other students. But I think it's a great question.
Mrs. Minor.
Let me say that this is exciting. It is good to know that we want to look at mastery. A long time ago, there was a discussion in this division about we want to have students that not only know but can do. And so I think we're returning to that, which was disrupted 16 years ago. So kudos to all of you for your participation in this grant and providing the opportunity. And like Dr. Beers, I have some questions about the profile of the 100. And would ask the superintendent what guidance or assistance you need from the board in this in policy that we may need to adjust, or what assistance you might need from the board, because I do know that we have a pilot program policy and we have a magnet school or specialized school program policy. So would we be using that for this, or do we need to create some other thing?
Those are all really excellent questions, and I'll get back to you isn't an appropriate answer, but we'll learn a little bit more next week when we have our 10 minutes with the state board. Subsequent to that, I envision that we will come to you with any kinds of policy or procedural changes or support that we would need from the board so that we can stay within whatever policies we have or ask for exceptions or deviations from policies to get this pilot program off the ground. We're not exactly there yet. I envision that probably in the next few months. We're going to learn a little bit more about the doors that will open at the state level, and once we know a little bit more there, I think we'll be in a better position to come back and talk with you.
As a personal aside, three graduates of the Williamsburg James City County Schools did their seat time, applied to their colleges, went into their specialties, and all of them are now in the creative arts, but in areas that when I was young didn't know exist, like you could have an advanced degree in managing arts and antiques and be making your money by selling fine art insurance internationally, or being a chef for a large corporation for one of their casinos, or managing and running a brewery, so a distillery, and managing and doing all that. So for parents, it's really sort of terrifying because we went through that, you know, you did your time in high school, you did your time in college, you went out and got your degree in this, and you went and worked in that. And for some of us of this age, we know that a lot of those jobs have gone away. And so anything we can do to prepare our young people for success over their lifetime by creative thinking and teamwork and collaboration would be really good. But I also know that we have a lot of work to do with our parents and the community around this new idea, and I'd be glad to work with them on any way possible. Thank you. Good work.
Great. My point of view, you know, education today in a lot of schools around the country has basically been the same since 1900. Teacher in front of a classroom lecturing and you know, students either grasping it or not grasping it, and grasping it for 20 minutes until the exam's done, and then not grasping it any longer. You know, I read the book Most Likely to Succeed. I went to the movie and saw the documentary filming last week, and you know, the high tech high, the concepts of project based learning. You know, in our day, my day at least, you know, the rote recitation of data meant that I was smart. You know, I knew, you know, 1492 and all that. And today, that's not, you know, what our kids have a phone that they've had since they were in third grade that can give them any piece of data that they need. So you know, I was kind of struck when you said, you know, you're excited, you're working with all these different, well, that's what we want our kids to do. It's all, you know, we have people from the education and from public schools and the school of ed and the school of business, and they're all come from different backgrounds and different interests, working together on a project which creates excitement and creates results and you know, creates engagement. And that's what we want our kids to do, because if they invest that time to get engaged and to understand the project, that is information that they're going to take with them, and being able to have those collaborative skills. And you know, when you go out into the workforce, you don't sit at a desk anymore and do whatever you used to do. I mean, I'm an engineer, so you don't sit at a desk and do your own design and then, you know, here, boss, I'm done. It's all done very collaboratively. And so this what we're seeing here is the future of education, and it's the future of how kids are going to learn in the 21st century. And you know, that high tech high, you know, I was struck by two things, and they both happened at the front and the back. You know, the opening scene with the parent teacher conference and look on that girl's face. Yep, she's right. And then the end with that kid. You know, 4 weeks after school's done, he's still at school working on that project, getting it done. So he was engaged and he was committed. And I think that's, you know, really where our society, you know, the businesses. Like you said, businesses don't want students to know how to do a multiple choice test, which as we've been forced to teach since. But our teachers don't want to teach kids multiple choice tests. The teachers want to have the reins free. They want to do the projects. They want to engage the kids, and they want to see that spark. So I think this is a great thing. We can say we're cutting edge, but not really. It's kind of been out there. I mean, but it's change. Change can be hard. Change can be tough for people, but I think we're definitely on the right track. So, you know, the 109th grade students, I share concerns about making sure you have good demographics. I think you're going to personally, from what information I've gained, I think the center is fertile territory. You're going to struggle on both ends. You're going to struggle on the kids that are, you know, want to do the AP and, you know, get the 4.85 grade point average, and then you got the other kids that are thinking about graduation. So I think we're going to struggle to get those kids, but I think if they invest the energy, invest the time, I think they'll get the benefits. And so I'm really excited about this, and I'm looking forward to it continuing to mature and continuing to move forward. So I thank you for the good work that you're doing, and you know, look forward to seeing where we go. So, and as Mrs. Miner and others have stated, if you need our help, we're here. So, thank you. So with that, takes us to 11.01, board members' comments. Do any board members have any comments tonight? Ms. Taylor?
Yes, so I really enjoyed the school spotlight this evening with Girl Power and Guys Matter from Matoga. Especially their school counselors, since I'm a counselor. I thought that was amazing, and I would love to hear more from our other schools about what we're doing to help give our students the tools necessary to build strong foundations. And I would also like to look at how we can work with our middle and high school counselors to reinforce the work that our counselors are doing at the elementary level. that would be really interesting to see. Also, I enjoyed my time at the VSBA meeting, working with all of the board members to learn more about our jobs and what we should be doing to work collaboratively. And I would also like to thank everyone who's here tonight, or was here tonight, to join us. And I appreciate all those willing to give their time and input during public comment. I think it's extremely important to have open discussions on topics, and especially those that impact our community so greatly. So thank you.
I'd like to echo some of Ms. Taylor's comments. We have had several topics come to the board over the last several months, and I would be interested in knowing what other board members thought and what the process might be. The first one would be the issue of school climate and how we might facilitate a climate study, and if there was other board members in doing that, what would be a good time for that. And then the other, we heard from the passionate plea of the folks who experienced the real world of Rawls Bird and how we might move forward to address their concerns in a meaningful way and how we might do that and what other board members are thinking about that.
Tom?
Thank you. I wanted to let everyone know that we're going to have a board meeting, I'm sure you're going to talk about it, on the 22nd, this Friday, where we're going to be, it's a joint board meeting with the James City County Board of Supervisors and the Williamsburg City County, and I will be going there because I'm a school board member, but I'm also hoping, I'll be there, but I'm also hoping that that they will support the CIP that we've all agreed and voted on, and I hope that they will support the funding for the entire CIP. I also wanted to say that we just came back last weekend from the National School Board Association meeting in Boston, where for me as a new board member, I found this, you go to conferences sometimes and you're wondering why in the world did I go to this conference, but this particular conference for me as a new school board member was extremely valuable. As you can see here, there's like 266 pages of opportunities for new school board members to learn about something. I was lucky enough to go to a lot of different sessions on things like how to conduct an engagement audit, or how to close the achievement gap in your school system. This is my particular favorite, facility master planning, building a compelling case for taxpayers. What you need to know about the Office for Civil Rights. So these are just a couple of the sessions that I went to, and as a follow-up, not only can I go to these, was I able to go to these sessions, but I also have access to all of the PowerPoints and all of the resources for the hundreds and hundreds of sessions that I didn't go to. So I just wanted to thank the school administration for supporting me as a new school board member to go to that conference. I also want to say that I am with Mary Miner on the Rawls Bird situation. I am a representative for the city of Williamsburg, but I met with Clarence Wilson and Barbara Harris because Clarence Wilson is the president of the NAACP here, and they had endorsed an African-American person to be the school board rep for the city of Williamsburg. So I wanted to reach out to them and say, I hope that you feel that I can also represent your concerns and your needs, despite the fact that I'm a white person. So I want to say that I support what I've heard tonight from the African Americans in our community
And I would also like to see us move forward, hearing all other viewpoints, of course, but I would like to see how we can move forward and address that situation. And I think that's it.
Mrs. Young?
I share the concern about Rawlsburg. I think we need to devise some way of addressing that issue. And whether we do that at a work session, probably need to be at a work session, I suppose. But I think we do need to address that situation. I'm also interested in a school climate survey. I have asked about that. I think that's coming down the pike. The other thing that I had asked for several months ago was a report on block scheduling or on scheduling, and I was told at that time there was a committee that was addressing those issues, and so I would like to request an update at some point about block scheduling or whatever the committee has decided. I like the National School Board Association. That was fantastic. And as a new school board member, that was very informative, I think. So we have a lot to learn still, a lot.
Yeah, I just want to reiterate my enthusiastic endorsement for that high school redesign plan. I would love to see that move farther down. I think probably the single most important areas to develop in children and to foster is the area of curiosity. That if we can help children really recognize that their curiosity can take them anywhere that they want to go, and we foster that and show them how to use that, I just think we're really a long way along the way, and I like to see that at the elementary school as well, some of that as well. The only other thing I would like to say about the Rawlsburg issue, and I appreciate it, I understand it, I believe that I listened very carefully, I think something that was said, and it sort of echoed what Julie was just mentioning, I like to think I represent all the children and their parents in not just my district, but in the entire community. White, yellow, black, red, doesn't make any difference to me. And simply because I'm not an African American does not mean that I haven't spent the better part of my life helping and working with children, particularly children who haven't had the advantages that other children have had. And you will note that on a number of occasions, that will be one of the questions that I generally will ask is, what about the kids at the other end of the spectrum? How are we going to help them? So with that, that's all I want to say.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. Mrs. Cook?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I don't have any great ideas about how, but I too would like to somehow figure out how to have a board level discussion about the Rawlsburg naming issue. So thank you for your attention. That's all I have to say. That's all I have, sir.
I'd like to acknowledge the comments of several board members about the NSBA and the VSBA training opportunities. I think once you are successful in getting yourself on the school board, you suddenly start to realize that is the beginning of your education. That you're in a whole new industry and a whole new terminology with whole new problems that you, even if you are in education, you might not fully appreciate it before you come on the board. And so I appreciate all the board members who've taken opportunities to take advantage of those educational opportunities and to work on board development. The 7 to 8 of us who sit up here really set the tone for the entire school division, and I think it's important that that the board be knowledgeable and conversant, and I really am excited about about this board's commitment to their education and to doing the good work of a school board. So I appreciate everybody making that investment. It is more than two meetings a month, but but I guess we earn our pay, right? So anyway, with that, I want to thank you for taking advantage of those educational opportunities, and also for the good work that comes through with the questions that were asked and the interest in the programming. So well done. With that, 12.01, upcoming events. CTE committee meets tomorrow at 4 o'clock at room 400 in the central office. VSBA Hot Topics Conference, another opportunity for board education. Mrs. Miner was good enough to give me the agenda here, and their topics include closing achievement gaps, changing the climate in Virginia, empowering learners for the future, kind of ponies off of some of the things we're talking about today. Student Advisory Committee meets April 27th at 3 o'clock at Lafayette High School, and we have the Teacher of the Year ceremony April 27th at 5:15 at the William Mary School of Ed. Strongly encourage everybody to attend. It's great to see the wonderful work of our teachers and all that they do. 12.02, upcoming meetings. As Mrs. Hummel mentioned, we have a joint budget meeting April 22nd at 9 o'clock in the brand new Stryker Center. Looking forward to my first visit there. We have a closed session May 10th at 6 o'clock in Blair, and followed by work session and action items also on May 10th, immediately following closed session at 6:30, also in Blair. And then our regular meeting begins with a closed session on May 17th at 6 o'clock in the Stryker building, followed by a regular meeting May 17th at 6:30 in council chambers. So with that, we are adjourned. Thank you.